meeting of Northwest Indiana School District Board at 5 p.m. Let the record show that a quorum of board members is present, that this meeting has been duly called, and the notice of the meeting has been posted in accordance with the Texas Open Meetings Act, Texas Government Code 551. We'll now move into closed session. The board will convene in closed session pursuant to Texas Government Code Chapter 551, including Sections 551.071, consultation of board's attorneys, and 551.072, real estate matters, 551.074, personnel matters, 551.089, security devices or security items, and 551.087, financial information from a business prospect, considering location in the district. Welcome, everybody. I'm going to bring us back into session for the open part of the meeting. But before we go further, we have a lot of people here for guest educator recognition, the leadership of ISD graduation, and folks from the community that want to come talk. But we have an agenda item later on about the voter-approved tax ratification election, also known as VATER. That's a very important topic for the school district, and it's going to highlight that our state leadership has failed public school funding. So it's one of those meetings you're going to want to stick around for so you can hear firsthand what's going on and some other issues. So I know after recognitions, it's more normally everybody vacates, and it's just only Northwest ISD employees and board members that are left. But this is one of those meetings, if you have the time, stick around, and it will be a short meeting tonight. So with that, I bring us back in regular session at 6:30, and have time for the invocation. Pledge of Allegiance to our first.
Will you guys please rise and join me? I'll invite you to first join me in the invocation if you'd like, and then remain standing as we have two of our students help us with the pledge this evening. So if you'd like to, please bow with me. Heavenly Father, we come to you, Heavenly Lord. We thank you so much for the many blessings that you showered upon the students, the staff, the community in Northwest ISD. We pray for godly wisdom this evening as the board conducts its business in public. We pray for godly wisdom for our district and campus leadership, for our teachers, and really for all of our families as we try to finish the school year and do so well. Lord, we thank you again, as we said, for the rich blessings we ask for your edge of protection for our students and our staff and all of our families as we go from here and as we finish out the month of May. These things we pray in the Lord's name. So I'd like to introduce our students and invite our two students from Cox Elementary up to the podium to help us in pledges. And as they come up, let me first introduce Runa Bazet, who is a third grade student at Cox Elementary. His parents, Naveen and Rupa Bazet, are with us. Thank you all for being here to support. Runa, his favorite subjects are social studies because he loves to learn about history. He likes to play outside, art, and listen to music. His proud principal, Ms. Oakley, said that he's a wonderful student. He enjoys coming to school every day. He's kind to others. And he's involved in a number of activities such as Cox's Cultural Night, Cougar Trade Days, UIL, Ultimate Book Challenge, Robotics, and Chat and Chew. And he's enjoyed to have at the elementary. We also have a fifth grade student, Ethan Trudeau, who's here. Scott and Kristen Trudeau, parents are with us. Thank y'all. Ethan's favorite subject is math. He loves the problem solving process. That's fantastic. I love that. He wants to be an engineer. I did not know what I wanted to do in fifth grade, so kudos to you for figuring that out. He believes that math is very valuable. He loves coding, card games, and playing board games. And his crowd principal, Mr. Oakley, says he's a hard worker. He always gives his best. He has empathy and is a role model for other students, and they're going to miss him in college when he goes on to big time middle school next school year. So, gentlemen, would you guys lead us in the pledges?
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honorable Texas is mine, I pledge allegiance to the state of Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Gentlemen, we all stay there for just 1 second. Mr. Schultz, our board president, is going to offer you a token of our appreciation. The rest of you all, please be seated. Thank you.
Thank you. past members of the board. Tonight we have a few recognitions. One cannot make it tonight, our April Volunteer of the Month. But just to put the agenda on course, we have boys basketball to start off. Then we have leadership in ISD and with our guest educators in the semester. So tonight we'll begin with our most recent city student athletes to finish near the top of their region. This is the boys basketball team. They recently had the best season in school history when they advanced to the UIL 6A Regional 1 tournament. So to provide more information about that, I'll turn it over to Joel Johnson, Executive Director of Athletics.
Good evening, Dr. Dallas, Mr. Rolls, members of the board. One of my favorite groups this year. I'm proud to have this group here in boys basketball. First thing I'm going to do is introduce them to you, and then once they get all up here, I'm going to talk a little bit about their team. So we're going to roll right through introductions, and I'm going to go very quickly with this. So, Kate, Ann, Lamont, Maverick, Emmanuel, Carson, DeAndre, Michael, Caleb, Darius, Carrington, Jaden, Jonathan, and then we have Coach Stuber and Coach Harmon here as well. So, one of the funnest things about the season is when you exceed expectations and you do more than people expect you to do. And a lot of people probably don't realize this, but when the season started, they had passed for picked fifth in the district. And talking about their season, they set a school record for wins in a year of 26. They were 26-9 overall, qualified for the playoffs third place. Second place, they beat Pascal in my district. They beat Midland Legacy in the area round. They beat Friendship in the regional quarterfinals and advanced all the way in the regional tournament where they lost to Atlanta Beast, which is nothing to hang your head about because nobody beat Atlanta Beast this year, right? They were like 41-0 in the state championship. So, those are accolades that you guys had as far as wins and losses and things in the board you should be proud of. But I want to talk about real quick things that not a lot of people probably witness or understand. Number one, walk by the gym at 6:15 in the morning at 8:30. Walk by the gym at, if they weren't up here, they might be in the gym right now. And you gotta take them out. So hard work was nothing that this group was afraid of, and I witnessed it firsthand. They're one of my favorite groups because they're so close. Their culture was so great. They cared about each other. They worked hard. They did everything they had. They were a great representation of Northwest ISD Athletics. And I appreciate that. I want to tell you that the one thing that stood out about you guys this year to me, y'all got coached pretty hard, didn't you? But you know what? I know a lot of your parents are here, and a lot of the credit goes to them, and I know a lot of it goes to Coach Thomas and your coaches. But every time I watched y'all play, I never saw one of you on the court do this. I never saw one of you grabbing the coach, grabbing the referee, or getting mad because of a call. You just held your head up and went back to work, watched Luke and Marvin grab about every call. That's what you see more and more common from grade 7th grade all the way to the NBA, and you guys didn't do that. And there's a mentality about that, and it's a small thing, but I'll tell you, if that's the way you live your life, you guys got a chance to be really, really successful, because there's a lot to be said for that. So thank you for what you did for Eaton Athletics. Thank you for what you did for Eaton Basketball and ISD Athletics. And congratulations on a phenomenal year and setting the bar for the crew to come after you guys. So, Eaton Basketball. Thank you.
set of recognitions is one of my favorite groups, not just because I'm biased and Bill run the group, but it's our leadership and ISD graduates. Each year we ask our campus principals to give us a nominee from their campus, or excuse me, two nominees from their campus. Doesn't matter their viewpoints, if they have concerns, if they just have accolades, we want their feedback no matter what it is. I think the one thing to remember about this group is they learn a lot about the district. There's a lot of things that are confusing about public education. Jonathan probably has the best topic that exemplifies that. So they learn everything about our growth, about our financial situation, everything we have to do as a district, and they meet with department leaders to learn about that. And they do a great job of giving us feedback. We've made changes based on the feedback that this group has given us in the past. They've been a great group. They come to one session a month and learn more about our district, more about public education. So without any further ado, I'll go ahead and read this year's graduates. First of all, we have Brenda Boss. I'm not sure if Michelle Cameron can make it. Mid. Then we had Kristen Cooper. Cammie Copeland. I'm not sure if Jim Davis made it. Nope. Bethany Ewing. Andrea Posh. Jasmine Giles. Rebecca Cudgel. Amanda Guerra. I believe David Hanna did not make it. And then we have Adam Hess. Candace Hills. Lisa Ojeda. Jeremy Holland cannot make it. Emily Hutchinson. Tabitha Ernick. Kiwi James. Randy Lee. Carla Medina. Jess Gabriel. Randy Romero, Belinda Sanders, I don't know if Shay Short can make it, and then we have Melody Shu, Amanda Smith, Monisha Smith, Ashley Stokes. Ashley Swanson. And Andrew Wells.
Hey, before we take a picture, I want to say something to the graduates. I don't think our bells are making any sense for the community. All now we come to the same thing about ourselves. In the district, you have to see behind the curtains. Don't know what the time is. And Mrs. Murphy's coming down, and she's a leadership and ISD graduate. I'm a leadership and ISD graduate, so this is just an amazing program that helps the community and helps the school district. So, congratulations. I'm glad y'all did. And these things, obviously, they're in the final thing that gives you a special. When I say that very first meeting, I say, hey, Robin, from our way, I'm sure, and we just said that, hey, the principal's giving you some privileges for you. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
alluded to, now they are community ambassadors, so they'll continue to give us feedback going forward. Next up, I'll turn it over to Lynn Lee, who will lead our guest educators of the semester.
Good evening. Imagine with me just for a moment what it would be like to go to a totally different job every single day. That is exactly what our amazing guest educators do. They step into a classroom filled with students who may be unfamiliar, adapting to various teaching styles, and seamlessly continuing the educational journey. The commitment requires exceptional flexibility, patience, and dedication. Our GEs embrace these challenges with grace and enthusiasm every single day. This evening, I feel so privileged to present to you two exceptional groups of guest educators. The first group are our guest educators of the semester, chosen by each campus. Some of the amazing comments made about these GEs are best smile, best attitude, calm and steady, flexible, provides individualized care, dependable, up for any challenge, has a put-me-where-you-need-me attitude, and the epitome of excellence. I'm honored to introduce to you 33 exemplary representatives out of our expansive roster of over 800 guest educators. Their unwavering professionalism and dedication deserve our highest respect and admiration. So, to begin with, from Eaton High School, Connor Cudmore. From Northwest High School, Elise Stevens. From Byron Nelson High School, Christina Ippolito. From Steele Early College, Noemi Olvera. From Adams Middle School, Jody Carter. Unable to be with us tonight, from Chisholm Trail Middle School, Christina Perriott. Also unable to be with us tonight, from Medlin Middle School, Andy Hess. From Pike Middle School, Rebecca Pavlett. From Tidwell Middle School, Mara Lansford. Unable to be with us tonight, from Wilson Middle School, Ashley Robinson. From Worthington Middle School, Rachel Dyer. Unable to be with us tonight, from Beck Elementary, Tori Boswell. From Berkshire Elementary, Magdalena Tortolero. From Carter Elementary, Violet Guyman. From Cox Elementary, Paula Swearingen. Unable to be with us tonight, from Curtis Elementary, Kelsey Prescott. From Daniel Elementary, Karen Scruggs. Yay! Also unable to be with us tonight from Granger Elementary, Jenny Massey, and from Hazard Elementary, Leah Rindleman. From Hatfield Elementary, Janann Anderson. From Hughes Elementary, Carrie Williams. Unable to be with us tonight from Justin Elementary, Melissa Buffy. From Lakeview Elementary, Jolie Taylor. Unable to be with us tonight from Lance Thompson, Tara Krause. From Love Elementary, Barbara Richards. From Nance Elementary, Curtis Fowler. From Peterson Elementary, Raymond Mitchell. From Prairie View Elementary, Jessica Helmer. Unable to be with us tonight from Roanoke Elementary, Maria Juarez. From Schluter Elementary, Ashley Frank. From Sendera Ranch, Candace Hill. From Seven Hills Elementary, Allison Goodson. And unable to be with us tonight from Thompson Elementary, Mackenzie Beisler. Thank you, our guest educators of the semester, for your unwavering commitment and outstanding contributions. We appreciate you more than you know. Thank you. So far this year. So an incredible commitment. So first up, with 140 days, Lakshmi Anna. Unable to make it with 140 days, Christina Harriet. Unable to make it with 141 and a half days, Jennifer Handelman. With 142 and a half days, Carla Finlayson. Unable to make it tonight with 143 days, Julie Lease. Also with 143 days, William Proft. With 143 and a half days, Lori Hanlon. With 144 days, Sydney Barnes. With 144 and a half days, Winona Daly. Unable to make it tonight with 149 and a half days, Shannon Govan. And also unable to make it with 151 days, Bradley Bronner. With 154 days, Agnes Natouche. Also with 154 days, Brian Stubblefield. With 155 days, Brandy Bolton. then we have three more that were unable to make it tonight with 156.5 days, Manis Kabongo, 159 days, Joshua Boyce, and 163 days, Hannah Copeland. I would like to extend a sincere thank you to each and every one of our guest educators. Your unwavering dedication to education enriches the lives of our students and contributes to the success of Northwest ISD. And thank you to the board for recognizing our guest educators.
Next up on the agenda, item 7, consent agenda.
Mr. President, I'll close the first and ask the board if there's any items they would like to hold up. Did you skip the testimony?
Okay. Thank you for that. It was speaking there. Okay, so we'll be back up. We'll come back to the consent agenda. Next up is item 6, public testimony on agenda items. Which there are none. Okay, next is consent agenda. Now a motion by Mr.
Okay, is there anybody who would like to follow the ground with that motion? Seeing none, I move to approve for the consent agenda as submitted.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Suter and second by Dr. Rush to approve the consent agenda as submitted. All favor. 7-0. Thank you. Next up, item 8, consider any item removed from the consent agenda. There were none. Item 9, discussion action item, and that is voter approved tax rate election. Mr. Dixon.
Good evening, President Bowles, Dr. Fowles, members of the board. I'm going to bring in consideration to talk about today about voter approval tax rate election. This will be something for the board to consider. I think we all know the state of finance in Texas right now for school measures. I want to have a little discussion about this for your consideration. This was our budget to begin the year, $279 million. It's in property tax, $58 million would be a original budget, $18 million, and then of course recapture was about $19.5 million. So it left our net budget $278 million. Currently, what we're looking at today from a 2024-25 projected budget, still coming from the state of $278 million. You can see it now, even though we know we're growing. That's because of the $100,000 homestead exemption that was voted on in November, as well as tax compression. The state also is in $18 million, giving our total revenue of $296 million, but our recapture went from $19.5 million to $7 million. So our net went from $278 million to $280 million. So the big thing I want to focus on here, of course, always is what's our net for next year's budget. You can see it's about $10 million in additional revenue, mainly due to the growth of our students. Next slide, please. After discussion, we started with a $2 million revenue addition. And after discussion from the budget workshops, we added the growth position. positions, the raise, the other things that we've talked about, that came to a total budget cost of $24 million, which left us currently at a projected budget deficit of $14 million. And that's where we've left the last budget worksheet. Again, going forward, where is that critical? We talk about the fund balance, protecting our fund balance. You can see that we need to stay at least above 3 months of operating for the first rating to make sure that we don't fail or get hit hard on that first rating for financial integrity. So fund balance will be at least 25%. So if we were to knock the $14 million deficit, and it turns out that I use this to be $15 million just in case, you can see it puts us at $92 million in fund balance for about 28% of the operating budget. You see just above the 25%. So I stole this from Community Impact. I see we have a representative here in the audience, and I stole some stats from that in their last article that I thought were really telling of what's going on in the state of Texas on the funding side. So this first one's going to talk about compensation. The average national teacher salary, the average Texas teacher salary is somewhere around $62,000, which is about $9,000 below the national average. With inflation, Texas teacher salaries are down 6% since 2015. The national average is amongst 50 states. Texas ranks 29th in teacher salary at about $71,699. That's the national average. And 34th in support salaries, half of the national average at $33,756. Looking at it from a funding side, you can see that Texas funding spends about an average of $12,781 per student. That's not just general fund, that's got to include IS and other things. This includes the basic allotment, which is where we've been since 2019, of $6,160 per student. Again, no increase in this since 2019. With that means our per student spending in Texas has dropped about 2.5% since 2022-23, while the national average has increased 2.9%. So Texas spends about $5,000 less per child than the national average. So where does that rank us? National 46th in per student funding, with a national average of $18,000. I'd also like to point out that Texas, if it was a country, would be 8th in GDP in the entire nation in the entire world. So that tells us where we stand in funding per student. Here was our budget priorities and the lenses we looked through into our budget. These were the lenses that we did everything on our budget for this current year. So first of all, we wanted to protect student programs. That includes our growth budget, right? We're growing students. We have to protect those programs. We need to make sure we have the staff. It also talks about ratio restrictions. We talked about more class size ratios and how we want to keep that where it is today. We don't want to raise that. And then program changes. So student programs that we need to change and we want to do on those. So that's the first thing, is protecting those student programs. The second one is how we maximize compensation for all students. We want to give the max raise possible. We want to do a pay scale adjustment for all of our teachers, the teacher pay scale, to get that UEHR like we talked about. And the last one is going to strive with the cross-bond disciplines. The last one is protect fund balance. The reason these are in red are these are the things that we need to look at for next year if we do not get any more funding. If we do not get any more funding, we will have to do some of the things that are at the national team, minimize hiring to reduce the staff, must increase class size ratio, look at which programs that we need to reduce or cut, what we need to do to those programs, possibly no raise, no changes or increases to any pay scale, and no changes or increases to any stipends. You see the last one I put in green is historical analysis with the balanced budget for fund balance. That is because that's the one that was in red this year. If you remember all the other things, we were able to keep green. So we sacrificed protecting fund balance this year a little bit to make sure we can accomplish everything else. But we can't do that again next year. So that's why that is in green, because that will have to be one of our goals to make sure we have a balanced budget.
I just want to interject here because it can be confusing. When we talk about next year, we're talking about the 25-26 budget.
That's right. Yes.
We're really deep in the planning of the 24-25 budget, which approved the growth budget. The board has approved the growth and the compensation plan. So we put together those final pieces. But in the next planning cycle, if there's not some change to our revenue, we will be looking at these things in red.
That is correct. 25-26 budget.
Yes, sir.
So So just a little background. I know we've talked about this a lot, but I want to make sure we cover it before we get into the discussion later. So there's two buckets in which schools receive revenue. One, we call it maintenance and operations, or M&O. It's basically our day-to-day operations. That's where we have all of our things like staff salaries, your utilities, supplies, fuel, those kind of things. We like to compare this to like your groceries, your utilities, car fuel, routine maintenance, those kind of things. If you flip over to the IMS side where debt and service, or debt service fund or interest and sinking, that bucket is only used for principal and interest payments on debt. It's only used for the bond payments when we take out a bond. And that is used for new construction, renovations, HVAC, those kind of things. Similar to your mortgage, your car payment, those kind of things. The importance of this is down at the bottom. On the right, you can see the IS bond election only for IS. That tax rate is only for debt service. That money cannot be used for M&O. So it is specifically used in that bucket and that bucket only. On the other side, you can see that we have general operating fund, and it says later election for M&O only. If you go out for a voter approval tax rate election, it will be for only M&O, so that will go strictly into the operations budget. We'll talk a little bit more about that as we go through this. But I want to make sure that you understand there are two buckets. You cannot use bond money in general fund money. Those are two separate buckets. So here it is, one tax rate, two buckets. Current tax rate for Northwest ISD is $1.902. The M&O portion is 0.6692. The INS section is 0.4210, which is 1.1902. This is Northwest's tax rate history since 2012. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but just know that the blue or the purple line at the bottom is the INS, the net, the bond payment side. You can see in 2012, 2017, it jumped up a little bit, but ever since 2020, we've actually been able to lower the tax rate, we put the debt side a little bit, and keep it static, keep it relatively flat, mainly due to our growth. That's what is passing two more additional bonds. If you look at the blue line, that is the M&O. This is where we operate out of. You can see it was $1.04 forever. In 2019, House Bill 3 came in where they started compressing the tax rate. The state told me what I can charge on the tax rate, started compressing our tax rate. As you can see, it's decreased all the way down until 2023, where they actually did compression twice. Once prior to us adopting the budget, once after we adopted the budget, they did a second set of compression. And then in November, the $100,000 homestead exemption was also passed. So that's where that dropped our tax rate all the way down from 0.8546 to 0.6691. Next year, currently, it's looking to be 0.6669, which is the floor in the state of Texas for compressed tax solutions. And then, of course, the green is the two again. So you can see we're at the lowest tax rate we've been. I don't think we're back to 1993, so over 30 years, it's the lowest tax rate we've had since 1993. Again, this is the same information. It's just put in table format instead. But what I'm focusing on is the 0.6669. That's why I've highlighted in green. We're going to talk about the M&O only. So what is a theta? Basically, our maintenance and operations tax rate of 0.6669 can only be used for daily operations. So we talked about the teacher salaries, contract services, supplies, fuel, those things. This where it gets the money, the water starts getting a little muddy, so everybody doesn't get too flashed over here. But so this is about 8 golden pennies that are not subject to recapture. Currently, the district has access to 5 of the pennies, which leaves the 0.6169 the current floor for the main tax rate set by state. Our M&O, as you saw on the last slide, was 0.6669. That includes the 5 golden pennies. You take those out, we get 0.6169, right? So that is with the 5 golden pennies. Those 5 golden pennies, every dollar raised stays straight in the school district, not subject to recapture. The rest of the money is subject to recapture, so we'll talk about that here soon.
Did you have a question?
Yes, sir.
Question for the audience. Does the DL know what he means when he says subject to recapture? If you don't raise your hand, it's... Could you explain your case?
Sure will. So I think I had it on this slide, but I want to make sure before I went through it. Recapture is when a property district is considered properly wealthy. So they have a ceiling of how much wealth we can get per student. So there's a minimum and a maximum. If you get above the maximum because your taxing rate or your taxing values in your district are wealthy, as they say, you have to pay the money back to the state. So tax money the taxpayers pay, I turn around and give to the state. Last year it was $19.5 million was the budget. This year, because of progressions, got $8 million going into the budget. So taxpayer money goes into the school district, and I have to turn around and pay it to the state because they consider it property wealthy. They're maxing out how much I can collect per school.
Basically, he's saying the property taxes we pay for Northwest ISD and Rainy, the Kellers, the South Lakes, Greater Colonials, it doesn't go to the district, but not all it goes to the district, it gets into the state. And this is one other topic where it may or may not be used for public schools. It may be concerned in the general fund, it may be used for the general or something else that's unrelated to in private religious schools altogether. But that's a different topic, because I'm already down that road. But it's very frustrating, so that's this will respond when y'all sit around and watch this, because it's very frustrating when it comes to talking to folks in legislators.
The 61 cents that they is subject to recapture, the 5 extra pennies that we get currently, only those 5 pennies are what we have control over and no recapture. So the school districts receiving any additional funding, but the only way we can get more funding is to offer what they call a VAR, or a voter approved tax rate election. And that means we can go after the 3 additional golden pennies or 8 copper pennies. I don't think anybody has some golden pennies, they only some copper pennies, but they're completely different, right? So the 3 golden pennies is what we're talking about today. The 3 golden pennies would be 3 pennies that we go out as taxpayers, that we go out and raise the tax rate, and all that revenue generated stays in the district, and none of it is subject to retention. Copper pennies are not the case. We would only be talking about the golden pennies, which would be subject or free from recapture, so that money would stay here. So again, this is the slide I just said. If the board was to consider 3 additional pennies for the VAR, for the M&O tax rate, you can see where that would change from 0.6669 to 0.6969. It would take our total tax rate from $1.879 to $1.1179. How would that affect our general fund budget? On the left is what I showed you a second ago with the $288 million we projected budget for 2024-25, or the $14.273 million deficit. Adding those 3 golden pennies would increase our tax revenue from $278 to $290. My state revenue also would go up a little bit. My recapture fairly goes up. It's a complicated formula. That money is not subject to recapture. But my net goes to $304. So we would generate an additional $15.2 million from the 3 additional golden pennies and all stay here locally. So I come back to this slide for one reason. My hope is if the board calls for the VAR and we were to pass it, all those red, hopefully, would not be paid next year. No guarantees. Again, there's a lot of things that can happen with the legislature still. But at that point, it would put us back into a balanced budget, which I think then we can look at the same lenses that we've looked at for the last couple of years of budgeting. We can continue on that path. But if for some reason we don't get any more money from the state or from a VAR, the red comes into play a lot heavier. How will VAR help? All the money will go directly towards competition, teachers, and staff, while maintaining the current high standards for all requested programs. By increasing the maintenance and operations budget to $115 million. This is going to sound a little repetitive, but I want to drive the point home. If approved by voters, a three-cent maintenance operation increase will provide funds for teachers and staff and pay raises. Again, 3 cents, 15 to 16 million, teachers and staff raises. So how will this affect my taxpayers? The average home value in Northwest is approximately $500,000. So on the left, that is our current taxable value. So we have a $500,000 home. We have a $100,000 homestead exemption. If you remember, your taxable rate would then, your value would be $400,000. And $1.879 per $100 of value, your total taxes would equate to $4,351.60. You do the exact same equation with the 3 additional pennies, the $1.1179. Your taxes would then be $4,471.60. That would be a yearly difference of $120 for the average
Lake in Northwest for a monthly difference of $10 a month. This right here is why we wanted to talk about it today. If the board decides that they would like to call for a mayor, there's a pretty strict timeline that has to follow. So the first one is, 4 months prior to the election date, the district must select an auditor for deficiency. With House Bill 3 in 2019, any mayor, the district must do an efficiency audit first. And what that entails is an auditor comes in, looks at our financial state, and compares it to 10 peer districts. And then we have to perform that name. So this would be something that we would have to do before July 5th. I've already talked about the auditor on board. If we decide that that's something we want to do, so that part is already taken care of, if we decide to go that route. August 9th is the last day to publish the notice of the public meeting. Every year when we adopt the tax rate, we have to publish notice in the paper 10 to 30 days ahead of that to have a public meeting for taxpayers to come in and talk about the tax notice. So you see 10 to 30 days prior. Usually, we have a little bit longer than that because we usually adopt our tax rate in the last meeting in August, so around the 26th, 28th, that time frame. But we have to move that up because of the mayor time. So we have to move that up because the last day toward the general election and adopt our tax rate. So we have to adopt the tax rate first before we can do the election. Must be no later than August 19th. That's why we would have to move it up, because our board meeting is set for Tuesday, August 13th. So we have to do the meeting on August 13th. 10 days prior to that would be August 3rd. So that would be the last day for us to publish the notice of paper review before then. But that kind of gives you the average timeline of how we have to work. And then, of course, the efficiency audit must be posted on our website by August 5th, no later than 30 days before the election. Again, the efficiency audit complete. Of course, we're going to post it, we have to be complete. And then on November 5th, of course, it's election day, and that's when the voters will vote. That is my presentation on the mayor. Can I answer any questions?
Jonathan, I would just like to clarify one of the slides that you had.
Sure.
And the places that we had, the reason for the mayor is for salary increases. And granted, that's the next one over with our mayor. So it's not only just for teachers, it's also for preservation of the programs that we have.
That is correct, yes, sir.
The comments I'm about to make are more for the audience than questions.
I would like Jonathan to explain. I think it sometimes gets confusing because voters do get to vote for our INS. The state has taken over really setting the tax rate, and you might clarify when that happened.
Yes.
And why we really do not have control over that M&O except in this situation. So I'd like to hear you explain that.
Yes. I'll go back to this slide. I think it shows it pretty well. It used to be that the max tax rate that a school district got was $1. And then they would have the 4 golden pennies on top of this. It was $1 plus the 4 golden pennies. And you can see that all the way through from 2012 to 2018. And even way before that, it was the same way. In 2019, House Bill 3 came in and it limited the growth of school districts in compressing the tax rate based on the growth of school districts. So the faster growing, the quicker it compressed. The logic behind it, supposedly, was to limit how much taxpayers would have to pay in taxes. And I think everybody here can agree that even though they compress the tax rate, we're still paying more in taxes. That's because it's not the tax rate. It's the value the state comptroller gives appraisal districts to make sure they appraise your property at. So from the state, they give a value for appraisal districts, and appraisal districts have to come and say, your value of your property is worth so much. And if they don't meet that requirement, there's loss of revenue that happens to a lot of people, and they can get in trouble. Well, so they actually set the values of the properties and compress our tax rate. So we actually have no voice in this other than the 8 golden pennies. It used to be we got 4. Then, I can't remember if it was 20 or 21, they went ahead and granted us the 5th golden penny without an election. So we were able to take that 5th golden penny. So now there's 3 still out there, 3 pennies that we have control over.
points for 9 copper pennies that we can also go after, but those are subject to recapture. We only have 50 cents in the dollar stays in the district. The other 50 cents we go out and recapture. And that will fill up this, right? But these little 3 pennies will all stay in house and stay in our district. So that is the only thing we have control. The state tells me what my tax rate will be every year by August 5th.
In addition to that, the state also gives us some parameters about what programs we need to have, what those need, how we need to staff those. And again, we don't really have control over that or another way to generate revenue. Is that correct?
That's 100% correct, yes, ma'am.
Yeah, in fact, Dr. Simpson, one of the things I was going to talk about is, we all just got our resumes on our houses within the last couple of weeks. It was a shocker to everybody. And this discussion is nobody here wants to have this discussion. But our state legislators telling us last for those of you in the state or just moved in, our state legislators meet once every 2 years to talk about everything for 3 or 4 months, and then they'll meet again in 2025. So we're trying to get prepared for next year. But the reason I mentioned that I said on this here, this is the city of Texas is sitting on a surplus of funds. And because they let politics and private school vouchers get involved in the mix with public school funding never happens. So we're having to use $2019 to pay for things at 2024 prices. And as all y'all know, groceries are higher, your car insurance is higher. The fuel for your car is higher, and it's the same thing for us every year. And with the inflation of over 20% since 2019, our teachers are suffering as far as what they're getting paid because of that. Even though they talked about 80-85% of that is staff. And so if you're a grade 4 guy and have to make cuts, it's going to come from staff. And that's going to hurt not just programs, but some of our students that are going to get the instruction they need because we need bigger classrooms with bigger classroom sizes. And I just say it's pathetic that our state leaders and the governor down to our state representatives and our state senators, they love politics, so they get involved. And now we're here. They've been a massive lockdown of us where we need to excuse all our payment property taxes because they're holding on to a surplus and they don't play political games with that problem that's in there. And it's very frustrating. And with the elections coming up in November, you're going to have candidates on both sides of the aisle running. And that needs to be part of the discussion. Why can we not get public school funded correctly? I mentioned before UAW went on strike earlier this year, or maybe late last year, because for some reason wasn't good enough. And they went on strike and they got the way. I think they had close to 40% or something along those lines. But we can only give our teachers a 2.5% raise, or a 2% raise, but it put us $15 million in the deficit. So, if they go down to Austin 25 and nothing changes, we're going to have to do Keller ISD cuts next year. And if y'all learn anything about Keller ISD there, I think 25 to 8 million in deficit and they're cut, things left and right, and it's ugly over there. So, we don't want to be cut. And so, we need your help. I guess the reason I'm going to go old when I get to it is we need your help to talk to our state legislators. You need to know who's in office and you need to engage them. I've kind of been saying, we need to be loud and make it a political campaign tour. When I get postcards, I'll get as many postcards as I remember. I want to see letters of public education coming even from the farthest right candidates. I want to see that on their postcard. But one thing, too, I like, and I know there's some teachers and principals in the audience, is when y'all talk to them, I want y'all to share, pay attention to what's going on in the classroom. Don't just be loud. Share how it's impacting you, what your daily life looks like. Make sure they know because our state legislators don't come to the campuses. We're working on it, we're trying to get them here. But this is a community problem, and we need to talk and speak as a community. And I have ran long enough, and anybody else want
to? I just have a question for Dr. Bowes. Because we do take this situation seriously, what are the different ways in which we can go about gathering input from our constituents? I know long-range planning is a community there, but would you just kind of outline what are some ways that we go about gathering
as important to communicate with our internal stakeholders, our families, and our staff. It's equally important to communicate with non-stakeholders, folks that don't have kids, you know, through our school system, to explain what Mr. Lucy just explained, but use our data or some of the things that we gather and we use those visual experts and get a lot of information.
And I was just thinking if people were interested in sharing what their thoughts were and guiding them to that. So, thanks.
One question to you, speaking of, let's say we do the Vayner November and our revenue gets approved. Would that be more reckless as a legislative session? They do their own thing based on the line, and they do their own thing in football schools, so we're not in the bottom of the United States. Can you undo the, can you take away the 3 cents to say the state did their part, now we don't have the 3 cents anymore?
Once the Vayner has been approved, it is part of the tax rate. I've never heard of anybody able to do that, so I really don't know the answer. It's possible. There is. I've had to do some research, but I don't know. I've never heard of it being done. What I would do, and you're now under the answer, what I would say is, you can see here in this cyber fund balance, this will allow us to continue to operate our district in the way I am meeting now. One thing that I will pride ourselves on is the programs we offer, the ratios we've been able to, and the skills we have to bring and give our teachers, unlike a lot of neighborhood districts, because of budget cuts. So I really believe that our competitive advantage would be that we can stay afloat a little longer than they can just because of our growth and continue to offer these things. And we pass a layer and we come back in with more money from the state. I think that really helps us solidify our place.
I just want to add to that if you go back to the slide where it showed a slight positive, so in the current year's budget, if this were passed in November, we would be at positive, but just barely, not by a large amount. That's just for our current, that's not considering any future inflation, any future raises for staff. It's not a one-trick pony because we need that additional revenue every year, but it really just brings us back to home. I think Mr. Masusi was trying to point out that picture of the, you know, our budget priorities and lenses, and then what's in red. What's in red is what's coming if a Vayner doesn't pass, because the Vayner just gets us back to just one to zero. With our current raises, and we can't continue without any raises and back in the staff, because we have to scratch the surface on inflation. For that, much less for the internal costs.
Again, I would agree that that's the best way to say it. The red, a lot of the red is structural deficit. I mean, it is a structural deficit. We're built in already for next year. We improve the pay raise. We can't take that back. We're stuck there, right? And only if you want to go higher. So that's already in there. So that gets us control. Anything on top of that should be allow us to continue to do more. And we're still way behind. Even if the state came through, I don't think the state would ever come through with the inflation rate was. I think it was like $1,200 in the basic allotment to get us through. And that was last year. And the last time I saw the highest they ever seen was $500. So again, we wouldn't be halfway there even with these. We're still chasing inflation, and we would still be trying to change the system.
I think what you're saying is something with the state is because of the fighters, they are not living on community members to make up the deficit. And that's just pretty easy.
That's a good question. If we decide we want to do this, how do you plan to educate the community so that they understand what you're telling us?
That's a great question. I will lean a whole lot on Mr. Tosi to help me with this, but we will be doing a lot of things. We actually have a meeting coming up to discuss all of our plans and what we would do, but I know there would be a whole lot of getting out in front of our staff and public to make sure we educate them on this, like we did last fall in the election, the sort of type of approach. I'm sure Dr. Kowski and me have a bunch of good ideas, but we haven't gotten to that point yet. There's lots of ideas.
We would be looking at weekly meetings like we did with the online. election. So it would be me, Dr. Faust, and Jonathan. I've already grown up with our team the potential for this, so we're already thinking about graphics, videos, what can we do with that. Direct mailers have been very effective in recent elections, so that's something we'll be looking at. The phone survey that Dr. Faust mentioned is to add poll and pulse in the community, and other ways, as Dr. Simpson was alluding to, of to get that community impact to make sure that we're answering the questions that they have, because we can push out all the information in the world, and if we're not answering what they want to know, then we're not being very effective.
I also want to make the point that with the look of this upcoming presidential election, there are a lot of stuff that could be buried in the bottom, right? So how do we not get this buried in the bottom? And that's my major concern, because it's going to be loud and ugly and crazy, and how do we make sure people understand this and recognize that this is a real local issue for us that's really going to affect everyone, no matter the outcome of this presidential election.
So part of that is getting out ahead of it. Once the election is called, there is a very fine line between what we can say and what we can't say. We want to make sure that we engage our grassroots. So that includes our staff, our primary stakeholders, things like PTAs, booster clubs, so they know what the end result of this is, which, as Jonathan and Dr. Fast have talked about, are primarily teacher and staff raises, protecting our programs. So we want to build that base up of our grassroots to make sure that they're informed, so that it's not just us making the communications, and we have a good base so that we are cutting through some of that noise and focusing on the messaging.
Okay, so, okay. Thank you, Mr. Producer, but I think you're saying right there, Arjun.
Yes.
Okay, next up is amendments to 2023-2024 operating budget.
Okay, if you remember correctly, we've talked a little bit about this. Usually all of our amendments go on consent agenda. But the reason we pulled this one has been the discussion we talked about the financials a lot and how the budget changed drastically prior to us adopting the budget. If you remember correctly, we adopted the budget in June. And then in July, the state added more compression for the special session silver tax rate down. And then in November, they had homestead exemption addition. $40,000 to $100,000, $60,000 that was taken out of that. So you can see why that drastically changed our budget. So usually we try not to do any budget amendments on the revenue side because we want to see how we're starting from in. But it's not really fair when all that changes. So what this is a pretty quick snapshot of what we had to change. As you can see in account 5711, which is your federal tax revenue, we had to increase that. All those changes from pressure and homestead exemption occurred, we lost $43 million in revenue. So from those two decisions this year, after we adopted our budget, the state made changes, and we lost $43 million in additional revenue. However, if you see 5811 and 5812, the state said, hey, we're going to hold harmless, and they did to a degree. You can see I got $16.5 million in additional revenue and $3.8 million in additional revenue. Doesn't equate at all. And you're right. If you look to the right, you can also see my expense for free capture was budgeted at 19. It was actually 19.5, where it's previous year money and recapture came in at $100,000, $200,000. So that's why I leave a little bit of budget in there. You see it decreased on the expense side by 19.3. You do all that math, it's off a little bit. The other thing is, if you remember the SMART program, where we receive reimbursements from Medicaid for students that need help and assistance, that was supposed to get this year about $3.6 million. After the school year started, the state said we would not get any of that money. We were down to $200,000 of our original $3.6 million. We have contested that, and we believe that we'll get at least 50%. Again, still not guaranteed, but 3.6, we had to reduce that down to 1.8, so that's why I will use 1.8. The other positive is, you can see it there in the red line, you can see pre-K, we're over our budget there. Interest earnings are up quite dramatically, and then other local revenues, just other than those things we've had this year, they're higher than. So you can see we have a total revenue budget change of 19.2 in revenue, and a total budget change in expenses. budgets in 1992, which now puts our revenue and our expenditure budgets at the same end of the 2.9 deficit as we originally adopted, so 2.98875 deficit. And that's what it still is. It's basically just more money, but I wanted to explain why and how, because when I start bringing financial strategy, you'll see these big changes that I don't want to come up super big. Answer any questions on the budget amendment? I know that's kind of confusing.
A few weeks ago, you mentioned something about charters, about possibly getting the money to go to a center. Any updates on that?
On getting the charge money?
Yes.
We have not been updated on that at this time. We have actually filed the first informal appeal, which then we had to do a formal appeal. The formal appeal goes to the federal government, and we're waiting to hear on that. So there's a number of school districts that. We were one of the first ones that actually got a formal appeal notice and received it, but they have not set our hearing date yet, so we're waiting to hear that.
Do you have any questions? Discussions? Great. Thank you, Chief Justice.
Thank you.
Yes. Oh, wait a minute, I'm sorry. We've got some action on internal legislation. Okay, this is a discussion action item, so I'll entertain a motion. Mrs. Apple, let's take a vote. Mrs. Scott, to approve the amendments to the 2023-2024 operating budget. That's all my questions and discussions. All in favor? That's 7-0. Thank you. Okay, next up, reports communication. District effectiveness report for the audience. This is the new old Facebook and the audience variant on Facebook Lives. Parents were here. Thanks, Mrs. Brandos.
Good evening. We're not here to talk about our communications department work we've done this year. I know that Mrs. Hatfield came back from Santa Madre just for this report, so I've got a lot to live up to, but I'll do my best. So this is our team. There are a couple new faces, Caleb Pierce. I'd like to kind of relay what our team does in the district as well as where they've been. Caleb Pierce was a teacher over at Eaton High School. She was great in that role, wanted something new. She has a daughter over at Eaton High School as well. So that's a connection that we have to the district. She brings a lot of great expertise from that role. We've never had a teacher in the department, only someone who came from teaching directly to in the department, so that's a great addition to our team. In addition to that, we brought Matt Mays. He has a son over at Berkshire Elementary School, so he brings the lens of being a dad in the community, so that's a great addition to our team. So one of our main goals in our communications department is to inform and engage our community, whether that's staff, whether that's parents, or anything along those lines. And the main way we do that is by telling our story. So we tell our story, we get feedback from parents, from staff, their input, so that we know what they're looking for, and it builds that two-way communication, because again, if we're just informing them, we're not doing our job, we want to make sure that we hear their feedback as well. Probably the primary way we do that is a lot of writing. So we have lots of communication that we send out via newsletters, via news releases, whenever we hire a new principal, make the announcement of the name of the school, location of the school, or anything like that. So we want to be transparent in those processes as much as we can be so that we get thoroughness and that parents know what's going on in our school district. We also work with the media. As Jonathan mentioned, we work a lot with community impacts, other local outlets we work with, Four-Star Telegram, Wise Community Messenger. They come to a lot of our events. They ask us lots of great questions. They hold us accountable, which is a great thing to have in the community. Sometimes they'll see things that we don't see, and it's great to have that kind of rapport with your local media outlets. They're great partners to work with. This is something that I think, honestly, we probably do just as well, if not better, than any school district in the state, and that's going out to our campuses, taking the
photo, is taking the video so that parents can actually see what's going on in our schools. If you were to compare us to a district twice our size, I would bet that we go to twice as many events. And we do that a lot to make sure that parents know what kind of lessons are being taught, the unique aspects of education nowadays, things like our academy programs. So it's not just something they care about, it's something that they can actually see. One of the ways that we deliver that is through social media. So we want parents to engage with us. Like I said, it's a two-way process. When I started school communications about a decade ago, social media was kind of coming on strong. It wasn't quite where it is now. But now it really is about whether it is where we go to know what parents are saying, what community members are saying. That can be on our page, that can be in private Facebook groups or anything like that. We want to make sure that we're monitoring that input, we're responsive to it as best as we can be, so that we can correct misinformation where we can make sure that we're listening to the feedback and going along with what our community wants. Another aspect that resides in our department now is creative services. This is really primarily Jennifer Beacon. She does a ton of graphics. If you would look at the mock election last year, she probably made somewhere between 200 to 300 graphics within like a span of just a few months. She is absolutely amazing at what she does. Here is one example of that. She's done two new logos for schools this year. One was Hughes, which had a very old logo that looked like something designed in Microsoft Paint a long time ago. And then the other logo was Nance Elementary School, which, if we're being honest, it wasn't actually a logo. It was an image, and it wasn't even a gold eagle, which is Nance's mascot. It was an old eagle. So we had some issues with that. So she did a great job of improving those logos and getting them up to date. I know people talk about AI and image generation all the time. I've made this reference before, but they don't need to worry about AI taking their jobs. They need to worry about Jennifer Beacon taking their jobs, because she does this very fast, very efficient. She's amazing at what she does. Here's something that we help our parents out with, and our staff, and our schools as parents, where we adopted it last school year. It's been a huge tool. I think, personally, my opinion is the benefit. I think most of our elementary campuses feel the same way. It's a little bit harder at the secondary level to get as much engagement as we like. They have different ways of communicating sometimes. Sometimes it's best through a different app. Sometimes that's through Sports U for athletic events and things like that, because they have integration with rosters and schedules. The parents where it has been a godsend. If you look at where we were even last year to this year, look at the engagement from post directions going from 25% of the district all the way up to 44% of the district. So if you think 44% of our families, parents are engaging with us in Parent Square, that is a huge amount. There are some that we know they don't want to engage that way, and that's totally fine, but to have 44% of our families engaging with us is awesome. You can also see if you look further down that list, some things that we've implemented more frequently are polls. That's gone up 265%, forums above 90%. So what that tells me is our staff is using it in more ways. They're getting more engagement. They're using more tools at their disposal for volunteers, RSVPs, classroom item signups. So this has been a great improvement for our district over previous communication, which was handled by a one-way communication tool, which was School Messenger. It wasn't a great way to get feedback. It wasn't a great way to listen to what our parents are saying. But this is all done, primarily done by Melissa Sean, who does a great job at this, in addition to our website. She keeps up with this constantly. She's constantly talking to parents who need support, staff who need support, but she's also in this. Letters in our toolkit are one way that we help out our campuses, or two ways we help out our campuses. This year so far, we've written 90 letters. That can be for various situations. I think the most common is probably at the elementary level, whenever we have an ambulance or a fire truck respond to a medical situation, which we're a big district, and that's happened a little bit frequently. We make sure that we communicate with their families so they know why there was an ambulance, why there was a fire truck at their school, because we have neighborhood schools at the elementary level. We want them to be aware of, hey, here's why there was an ambulance. There's no need for concern. So we just want to be transparent in that process. And the campus communication toolkit is something that we give to our principals and our office managers so that they're aware of what's going on district-wide, and that they can share that within their newsletters, within their social media. they do a great job of having that consistent messaging. So that was one piece of feedback they gave us, was make sure that we have a district standard whenever we have district events, whenever we have district news, so that it's all coming across the same way and there's no confusion. Events are a big part of our department. We love doing them. Supporting students is one of the key pieces of our events that we have. Many of these events have been going on 15 to 25 years, so we've grown from a district the size of roughly 5,000 students to now 31,000 students, and we've kept up with these events, which I think is something that we're all very proud of, not just the communications department, but the district as a whole. Angel Tree, as you all know, only gets bigger. We went from having 1,500 last year to having, or excuse me, 2 years ago, it's last year, to having 1,600 this year. Same with back to school fair. Those are serving primarily the same audiences. Students on free and reduced lunch programs, free and reduced meals, I should say. So we want to make sure that we're giving back to them, that they're getting the resources that they need. We typically grow by about 100 students a year at both those events. And then our trustee awards of excellence, which began this Thursday at Green High School, they are a great way to make sure that we're recognizing all of our students who have great accomplishments every single year. Some other events that we have are our growth and planning events. We had a lot this school year to definitely help out with that. We had 5 dedication ceremonies because we had 5 brand new school openings. That was the most dedication ceremonies we've ever had in the district. And we're currently looking at 4 groundbreakings or topping out ceremonies, just depending on the schools. So obviously, we have 2 elementary school replacements. We've got middle school coming out of high school. So we've got lots of events to kind of keep us tied up for quite a while. I would mention that this is a district effectiveness report. We did 25 scripted events this year, which is double where we were a decade ago. So I would say if the question is, are we being effective, we are definitely being effective with our time to go from 12 to 25 in that time span. We also want to make sure we're supporting education overall. We do Northwest Range, which has been going on about 20 years in Northwest ISD. We get lots of great parent involvement in that program. They come out in droves, they read to our schools, our elementary students. We also give some of our high school students to read. I know we did a great job of having some of our high school students going over to Schuller Elementary School reading over there. And then it's just a great event overall, something that we're proud to do to make sure that we promote childhood literacy, which is something that obviously we focus on in our strategic framework. The Inspire Celebration, which again is a great ceremony to recognize our retirees, our teachers of the year, our educators, all of those groups. We want to make sure that we're making our students and staff, excuse me, our staff feel very appreciative for what they do. And then finally, we do convocation every year, and it's going to be big this year, just like it was the last 2 years. We already have a theme that I cannot tell you yet, but I know that our team is very excited about. I think our teachers will be excited about it too, so we're looking forward to that. And then we support them whenever they have events. We want to make sure that they have all the support they need, because if we can take that stress off of them, it's more money that they're raising for our teachers and students. In terms of our department success, we won 11 awards at our TSPRO, which is Texas School Public Relations Association's conference. That's a good amount for our team. Each individual who was eligible for an award, so if they just came to our district, they couldn't apply yet. They each got a gold in whatever category they entered in, which is a great accomplishment for everyone on our team. They all do great work, and we're really proud of all of them. I do want to talk about some of the new initiatives that we undertook this year. Every single one of these things, except for one, I talked about last year about something we were going to take on, so this is an update on that. Probably the biggest one was listening sessions. It was an undertaking not just for Captain, but for my team, scheduling them, planning them, doing the questions, doing the research, and Kara definitely helped out with the analyzing of the actual results. So there's been a lot to get into that, and there's more coming with that that I'll go over in a few slides from now. But this has been a great way to listen to our staff, make sure we know what they're feeling, because up here we're not always going to know what they're feeling, we're not always going to know how to reach us, so we want to make sure that we're listening to our staff. Watchdogs is another program that we re-implemented. We've had it before, and then the program itself went away nationally. They brought it back, so we were proud to bring that back in our school district. It has been very successful at the elementary level, as I mentioned before. We also added it at the middle school level. It's a little bit more of a challenge there, just in terms of the parent involvement. We know that they kind of send their kids off more frequently, don't want as much involvement. They want them to be more self-sufficient. Same at the high school level. Obviously, we wouldn't have this program there. But we'll keep analyzing that and see ways are is something that we added this school year. Previously, we had something called the community folder, which is something where we manually updated, flyers from across the community. This is an industry standard. Many of the school districts around us have this. So whenever our schools have an event, whenever some of our community partners have an event, like the City of Roanoke, City of Justin, other entities, if they have an event that's appropriate for students, they can submit it into this flyer service. It'll go out to all the students and staff at that school, families at that school, I should say. The branding guide, again, something that I brought up last year. We are very happy that we got this in place because we would frequently get questions, hey, what is the very specific color for this school? What is the RGB color? What is the HCO color for the website? What is the Pantone color for whenever we're repainting the school? Well, we wanted to make sure we had that resource for every team that we have, whether it's a principal, whether it's facilities, whether it's someone working on the website, so that they knew the specific colors, they knew where to go to get the logo. We have all of our logos now in a vector format. That means it can be resized. That was something that we had an issue with for the two logos I mentioned previously. They could not be resized. You can only have them in very small types of graphics. Wouldn't work very well on t-shirts. Wouldn't work very well to be painted on the school side, the side of the wall in school, unless you were doing it by hand. So this makes that process much easier, and we'll keep expanding this branding tool, branding guide, going forward. Another new program that we didn't talk about last year that's been a great asset for us is Community Dashboard. That's basically a quick list of everything we have going on at Northwest ISD in terms of what our families say is important to them. We have things like our CTE programs, our testing scores, our demographic makeups, things along those lines. We wanted a one-stop shop where people can quickly go to see what our district is about. We have lots of information there as well. So this is not the end of this, though. I would say this is the start. We wanted a starting point. We want to keep advancing this going forward so that we're getting the kind of information that our families want in terms of are we being successful in terms of our educational and extracurricular initiatives. So now I'll talk a little bit about our future initiatives. I'll try to go fast on this because it is over a four-year span, so I don't want you all to get too attached on something and think it's coming next year because that would be very hard on us. One thing we want to do is specific mailers. We previously did something called the Northwest Vision. It had a generic template that we would use every year. It was very similar in terms of the content. The dates would change, the figures would change, but for the most part, it was pretty much the same message every year. Going forward, we want to focus on how can we inform our community better on the programs that are unique to them, that interest them. And there's no better example right now than our growth after we just passed a roughly $2 million bond. So I'm working with Tim right now. We're meeting this Friday to go over a construction mailer. We want our families to know, hey, you just passed this bond. Here's everything that's coming with it. Here's a rough timeline. Here's some more information. Here's renderings. Here's where you can go to get more news. So that will go out to everyone in the entire district, not just our families, but anyone who resides in Northwest ISD. We budget for that every year, but we want to make sure we're doing a good job of informing our families and anyone who's not a parent in the district. We want to make sure that they know we're using the taxpaying money that they give us wisely in terms of the programs and services we're offering. Going forward, some of those we want to focus on are things like CTE. We have an amazing academy program. Early childhood, that's really going to get bigger going forward, especially with early childhood centers. Family involvement, which is kind of the diamond in the rough that people don't know about, so we want to promote that more, just going forward to make sure that families are informed. So here's a longer list. Again, this is going to be over a four-year span. It is alignment with our district strategic framework that we passed this past year. Going forward with staff listening sessions, we don't just want to do them. We want to provide our staff with here's a list of everything that you've done in response to what you said. Because if you give a piece of feedback in your staff listening session, and maybe it wasn't duplicated across the entire district, we want you to know, here's what the entire district said. We couldn't get to everything, but here's all the things you said in terms of helping out our paraprofessionals with their devices, staff raises, things like that. So we're going to have a web page that's going to document everything we do so that people will see that we are really taking their feedback. We're making sure we do what we can. And even though it may be a minor thing in one campus, we're still going to monitor that overall list and see what we can do if it was a piece of feedback that makes sense. Staff retention and recruitment haven't quite worked out all of this yet, but we'll get with HR will make sure that we're doing a good job of recruiting and retaining our staff. So campaigns in terms of reaching future staff, making sure that our current staff feel appreciated, that's something that we'll go over in the coming years, this coming year, excuse me, and even further out beyond that. New family information, something I talked about last year. We couldn't quite get into it this year. We have lots of new families coming to our district every single year, even though we grow at the 1,200 students a year rate. I think we said it here enough that that is in actuality about 6,000 to 7,000 new students, because you have the students who graduate and the students who move away. So when you're replacing roughly a fifth in your district, a fourth to a fifth in your district each year, that's a lot of families you have to communicate with, make sure they know where to go for resources and things like that. Campaigns, which I mentioned earlier, standardization, something that's big to me. I want to make sure that our principals have the resources they need. A great example of this is this PowerPoint template. We want to rebrand this for every school in the district, so that even though this has the Northwest ISD maroon and white, that Byron Elson will get a version with their blue with their logo, and then every school in the district has something they can use going forward. But that's not just for this template, it's for everything that we have in terms of graphics, in terms of communication, so that it's easier on our principals and they don't feel like they're spending an inordinate amount of time doing things that are better suited for my department. And then finally, when it comes to crisis communication, we want to have templates on hand in terms of alerts, so that if something bad ever does happen, we obviously have the resources we need in place to respond quickly. We already have many template letters, as I mentioned before, the ambulance letters, the EMS letters in our elementary school, but this would be adding things like alerts and parent squares so that they can quickly press a button and get that information out there. But that was everything I had, unless you all have any questions.
Mr. Dempsey, one question was to say thank you to you and your team. You've done an amazing job. Thank you. I got on board in 17, and now my first hire, I kind of joked that all y'all did was just Twitter. We go back on Twitter, now we're talking to yourselves. People in the community yet are on Twitter, they're on Facebook, and y'all made the focus, and now you just, now that you've been in charge, you've just really grown the program and improvements on each other. There's really no question on the database of what's going on with the district. In fact, when I look at records and social media, someone asks certain questions, hey, I didn't see anything on this. The parents are saying, it was the parents who were asking you on Tuesday before, so it's all the parents are able to answer questions right away. And of course, the engaging you on Facebook, through the Facebook lives, or just messaging in general, is good or not. It's great. I just stay on top of that and answer the questions right away. So, great job on your team. And again, y'all do a lot besides just a few.
This is what I was going to say. There's only seven of you, and any time I go to an event, there's one of you there or two. And you're going, they're everywhere. I appreciate what you do.
Thank you, Gordon. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, next up on the agenda is public comment on non-agenda items. We have five speakers tonight, so I'm going to read a statement to the speakers, and then I will call you all up one at a time, and then I'll let you know who's on deck by virtue of that as the news comes up. So, public comments are an opportunity for the public to address the board on any matter not on the board agenda. The board may place reasonable restraints on length of presentation so long as it does not unfairly discriminate speakers based on viewpoint. People who wish to speak must decide to complete a public request to speak form before the meeting began and identify the topic they wish to address with the board. Each presentation is limited to 3 minutes. Speakers requiring language translation will be limited to 6 minutes. Speakers should refrain from mentioning by name an employee or student about whom they are complaining. The board may not deliberate or take action on the presentation about an item not on the agenda. Our first speaker will be Jared Wyman. If you could please step up to the podium to state your name and address, and they will be followed by Rebecca Combs.
Good evening. My name is Jared Wyman, and I'm speaking to you today to advocate for my daughter's safety, as well as the safety of the 24 other students and staff members, and the 7 staff members that were threatened at West Coast School, and to address the concerns regarding the school's response to terrorist and threats of violence. Being told that because student records, including discipline, are protected by the Federal Education Rights and Privacy Act, or FERPA, neither the school nor district will share specific disciplinary responses. CFR 99.36. This section of FERPA allows educational agencies or institutions to disclose personally identifiable information from education records to appropriate parties, including parents of eligible students, in connection with an emergency situation that threatens the health or safety of the students or others. Key points in this section include emergency situations and appropriate parties. Emergency situations. Disclosure is permitted when the information is necessary to protect the health or safety of the student or other individuals in the event of an emergency. Appropriate parties. Disclosure may be made to parents or other appropriate individuals, including law enforcement, public health officials, and trained medical personnel as necessary to address the emergency. I'm requesting access to information regarding the individuals who made the threat against my daughter, her classmates, and the faculty members. This information is critical for ensuring my daughter's safety, as well as students at Wilson Middle School and faculty members, both in and outside of the school environment. So I acknowledge the school's concerns about FERPA guidelines, and I emphasize that FERPA allows for disclosure specifically in health and safety emergencies which arise in the current situation. My daughter's life, along with 24 classmates and 7 faculty members, was threatened at Wilson Middle School and Northwest ISD. The school district are both stating that due to this FERPA guidelines, they cannot legally provide the names of those who made the threats, along with the names of those who edited the watch list. FERPA has an exception to this information can be provided to me. I have a commitment as a parent to ensure the safety and well-being of my daughter. I believe that you, the board, the district, and Wilson Middle School have the legal ability to provide this information as well as more reason to do so. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Okay, next up will be Rebecca Combs, and on deck is Samantha Mercy.
Okay, I didn't prepare all that, but that was awesome. So my son was on this original list. He reported this back in February. It was 4 students and 1 staff member. This was reported by multiple students to this staff member. I spoke to the VP of the school of 8th grade, and he basically was defending the teacher and telling me that kids were weakens. I was told that it wasn't reported by this teacher, and the reason for it was because things have to stack up in order to report it. My questions are, did FBI investigate this because it was labeled as terroristic threats? Who investigated this? We weren't told who other than the staff of the school, I guess, and supposed former police. How do you know that others are involved? Because what I've heard from the public was that there were multiple other students that were involved with this, that heard about this list, that were sitting next to the student while the list was being created, people that hang out with this student. This isn't the first time that the specific student has been in trouble before. I want to know why I was told that the teacher didn't report it, but then there was an email stating that from the teacher saying she did report it. Very contradicting information. I want to know why it wasn't taken seriously back in February when the original reports from these students were made and why it escalated to the point that it has. And lastly, my son and my children, all my 4 children, will not be back to NIC until I have answered them, until I feel safe to return back to school. And then one more thing, I'm sorry. And then I wanted to request the information and verbiage of the terroristic threats, not names listed, but I think us as parents, multiple of us wanted to know what the verbiage was that this student had on this document. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next up is Samantha Garcia. Again, first of all, you can state your name and address. And next up, Sasha Baxter. I apologize if I said that wrong.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Samantha. I'm also here advocating for my son. He was one of the 25 students on the list, and I apologize if I get very emotional, as I'm sure most of you have been emotional. Jerry did a really good job about making pretty much telling us, hey, the school's safe, go ahead and come there. But that's all we got. How do I know my citizens? Our neighborhood is in their range, is very small. This kid can see my son out on the street playing basketball. He can see him at the CVS. He can see him at church. We only have three churches in our area. But what do I say to my son that's asking me, Mom, hey, why can't I go play outside? What do I tell him? You can't right now, son, because you know what? Somebody can try to play. We got no information as to what was said on that list. I agree with Rebecca. We at least should know exactly what was said so we can figure out how to keep our children safe. I also wanted to talk about, I know I only have a minute, but they said that there is no way they can expel these children. But looking at this, it does say the student may be expelled if the student engages in conduct involving a public school and contains the elements of the offense or a false alarm or report under section 4206 Penal Code or terroristic threats. That's exactly the email we got. So I'm not understanding why these kids are not involved. Thank you.
Thanks, Ms. Persu. Okay, next up, Ms. Baxter, I'll have you say your first few words to you. And then finally, Angela Hasbro.
Hi, it's Natasha.
Yes, thank you.
I'm here to kind of speak on behalf of the whole district, but I do have a child at Wilson Middle School. And I'm just going to read what I wrote so I can stay on track. My name is Natasha Baxter. I'm a former ISD graduate, and I currently have two students attending Northwest. I'm here today to advocate and address my concerns regarding bullying in the district. I'm not one usually to speak out, but the conversations I've had with many parents, students, and teachers over the past year has become very alarming to me and has pulled at my heartstrings. I'm a very empathetic person, so I can feel these stories I hear, and it truly breaks my heart. I have been fortunate enough that my kids haven't been part of any major bullying, just small, normal stuff that I can teach them how to handle. However, we all parent different, we all teach different, we all take criticism different, and we all learn different. God created us to be unique. The growth of NISD has grown tremendously, and with that, I believe our policies and procedures should be adjusted to accommodate the growth and diversity of our community to keep us all safe and held accountable. I just ask that you please keep an open mind and hear my plea that there is a lot of bullying going on inside of our district. Because of this, a lot of students and teachers are afraid to come forward because teachers are afraid they're going to lose their job. Students can take the risk of getting bullied even more. Parents are not being heard. Instead of catering to the ones trying to stand up or catering to those who are causing the issues, we need to go back to our core values, do what's right, be honest, and document everything. We need administrators and HR getting involved more. I feel like the district needs to be communicating better with students, staff, and teachers and administrators so that everyone can be on the same page and understand what's actually happening in our district and work together and come together as a community to come up with a better solution to keep our community safe. As a former student, having my own kids in this district and being extremely concerned for them right now and their safety, it's a super scary world that we live in, but I do believe that we can all come together and fix the issues that are arising from our own eyes with better communication, listening, and observing the environment surrounding us. May God bless us and keep us safe.
Thank you, Ms. Baxter. Next up, Angela Eastwood.
My name is Angela Hazelwood. I am the mother of one of the 25 students named on the recent watch list of the troubling violent document maintained by some students at Wilson Middle School. 2 years ago, my husband and I had the opportunity to meet with Dr. Hicks at a parent group discussion. At the time, there was a big push for school safety after bullying.
next up on the agenda item is I have 12 board presidents report, and we've got a very busy next few weeks on the board. First up, we've got the board of trustee boards, E High School on May 9th, Byron and Nelson High School on May 14th, Northwest High School May 16th, and then, of course, graduation is not far after that. And then May 28th is the primary runoff election, with early voting being May 20th and 24th, and this may determine who's going to be on ballots in November. And then the summer, we have the TASB SLA conference, is June 19th through 22nd, and then next September, next fall.
It's similar to the busy items. If you want to catch one of our theater productions, Leaping Mod at Byron Nelson High School, if you're not this Thursday, one show, and then two shows on Saturday, May 11th. Also, we have the top 10 there for Eaton is May 13th. That's 5:30 afternoon. We have senior awards for all four high schools that are